Intolerance to whom? Intolerance to certain substances, popularly known as allergens. Now, interestingly, all these substances are not at all harmful to the normal individuals. However, they create a lot of complications in case of sensitive individuals. In that sense, it could otherwise be defined as hypersensitivity to certain substances. Actually, it was Professor Middleton in the year 1891 who first gave a comprehensive definition about the term allergy. He said, it is an antigen-antibody related abnormal reaction in some parts of the sensitive individuals to some external substance popularly known as allergy. I repeat, it is an antigen-antibody related abnormal reactions. So if it is an abnormal one, something is normal. So what is the normal phenomenon? The normal phenomenon is that antigen-antibody mostly ultimately leads to immunogenicity, which is very much helpful for the body's immune defense. However, there is a single antibody, popularly known as IgE antibody or reaginic antibody, interactions with the antigens, they always leads to deleterious effect, that is known as allergy. Now, what are the complications? The complications include very simple skin rash to life-threatening bronchial asthma. Now, just have a look on the possible allergens in our surroundings. Now, what is allergens? Allergens are nothing but high molecular weight proteins or polysaccharides, which when introduced into the body system may elicit the production of antibody. Now, among the possible allergens in our surrounding, the most important are the pollens, as you know, the fungi, animal dander, fur, feathers, dust, etc. Besides, you are used to, I think, there are many foodstuffs like prawn, eggs, milk, nut, brinjal, etc., which may lead to allergenic reactions after ingesting all those substances. Occasionally, some cosmetics, some perfumes, metals may act as contact allergens. Reactions to some drugs is not uncommon. Say, for example, sulfur-containing drugs. Whenever you used to go to the doctor, usually ask, do you have any allergic reaction to sulfur? Usual question, is that it? Whenever you introduce any penicillin injections, before that you have to go through the skin reactions, is that it? So naturally, there are a number of drugs, they show some sort of allergic reactions. Now, if we get back into the, these are the some photographs of common allergens in our surroundings. If we just get back into the historical details, or historical, allergy is very, very newer branch of science. That means the science allergology is coming to the market. I'm sorry to say the word market is very recently. How? The term allergy was first coined by Professor Van Parkway just in the year 1906. And he described this phenomenon as change state. Change why? Because the normalcy is that, like, antigen-antibody always leads to immunogenicity. And there is a deviation, that's why it is known as allergy, that is change state. But the main credit should belong to Professor Major, who first of all identified that asthma, you know the asthma, is popularly known as hapani in Bengali, in my language it is known as hapani, breathing shortness. That is actually first of all pointed out by Professor Mitzer in the year 1910. He first pointed out that asthma is an allergic reaction. Earlier, what happens? Earlier, the idea was like that. Asthma is an infection. So what happens? Number of antibiotics are profusely used, but in vain. Nothing could be happened. You need only simple anti-allergic tablets, nothing more. No antibiotics, nothing. So this is actually the major breakthrough. Major first of all pointed out that asthma is an allergic process, not an infection. Since then, the knowledge of allergy advanced at a rapid pace. During the 60s, several workers throughout the globe worked relentlessly on the causes and mechanisms of different allergy reactions or diseases. During the 70s, you just see, the subject allergy has been recognized as an important branch of medicine. So very recently it has been considered as an important branch of medicine. However, the major breakthrough occurs after the identification of a peculiar type of antibody which is known as reaginic antibody, as I have told you, that is nothing but the IgE antibody. So a major breakthrough occurs after the identification of the reaginic antibody. Who identified these things? Professor Johansson at Leiden, Sweden, and at the same time, parallelly, Professor Ishijaka from Japan. At the same time, in the year 1967, they jointly ultimately published the thing, the presence of a fourth or fifth category of antibody that is known as IgE antibody. So, after the methods of estimation and molecular characterization of this IgE antibody, this actually opens a new vista in the field of clinical allergy, that is diagnosis and treatment. So we can safely conclude that it's a newer branch of science. So far, the information is there. Now, allergy, just I'm giving you an estimate. It is popularly known as a growing concern. Why it is a concern? What are the reasons behind? So, allergy is one of the most common clinical problems prevalent in the developed countries, mind it. It was earlier confined only in the developed countries. It's a problem of developed countries, not us. So what happens? At present, 30% of the general populations throughout the globe suffer from one or different forms of malady during their normal lifespan. And it is estimated that, it's estimated as the fifth leading chronic disease in the USA, and estimated 50 million Americans suffer from all types of allergies. In a concluding remark, I can humbly state that recent surveys suggest allergy reported almost one in every four individuals. So it's really a concern nowadays. It becomes a problem nowadays. Just have a look on my own country, where I'm working during last more than 30 years. As usual, we don't have any own data. It's our legal. It's one kind of our legacy. We don't maintain our data. What happens, I don't know. Data in these regards in Indian countries is still fragmentary, but there is an indication. What is the indication? A threefold, that means 2.78, around 3% was identified in the year 1966. Just after 30 years, it becomes 10 to 13% in the year 1998. So it clearly shows that there is an increase among the urban residents during the last 30 years has been noticed from different parts of the Indian provinces. In India, it's a rough estimate, I'm sorry to say, it's a rough estimate. 250 million people are suffering from one or more allergic manifestations. Now, allergy becomes a growing concern, actually for the third world countries. The prevalence of allergic diseases are more common in westernized and developed countries. It was earlier a problem of westernized countries, not ours. An illness of wealth, usually known as illness of wealth. But the concern is that incidence is increasing in developing countries too, becoming double, even triple in the last few decades. This is actually the growing concern. Nowadays, the problem we are facing, mostly the percentile increase of incidence of allergic manifestations in third world countries, including India. Interestingly, this is very much important, you should maintain, that is interestingly 70% of these actually trace to change in lifestyle. The so-called modern living. I'm sorry to say the comment like that, it's the so-called modern living. Now, whatever we have identified during the last 30 years, it's a summary. These are the reasons, this may be the possible reasons regarding the prevalence of increasing endemic space in India too. Why? First, in metamorphic in change in lifestyle. It's really a fact. It's a fact. There's no doubt there is a change in metamorphic, that is, I have to say, metamorphic change in lifestyle in Indian community. Diet and dietary habits. We have already forgotten regarding the traditional foods. We are very much used to about the packaged food, packaged drinking water, packaged liquids. Acquisition of Western lifestyle. Standard of indoor environments should be taken into consideration. increased air pollution, they are aggravating factors. Booming beauty business, I'm sorry, the ladies are there. This is very much important, booming beauty business, use of cosmetics, number of cosmetics before sunrise, after sunrise, so many creams they are using. So without knowing anything about the ingredients, I'm sorry. So booming beauty business, use of increased use of cosmetics, lotions, creams, etc. And besides all these things, the habitual differences, use of soft toys, upholstery, foam mattresses, and instead of conventional cotton mattress, padded furniture, intolerable psychological stress. Stress is becoming more and more and more. And this is actually very much linked with the from T1 to T2 transformations. So naturally what happens, this has been identified as a major reason why it is a growing concern for Indian community. And it is increasing day by day, I'm sorry. Now, why it is a concern? Ultimately, actually the allergic manifestations, it's better to call manifestations, adversely affect the quality of the life of the patients as well as parents and the other family members, there is no doubt. High burden on the economy of the individual, family as well as the country. In USA, it is estimated that the medical cost only to treat allergic rhinitis, only a single manifestation, is around 53.4 billion annually, excluding loss of school days as well as the loss of work days each year. Besides all these things, there is a decreased productivity. Usually, you know, the anti-allergic tablets are usually sedatives. Some sort of sedation is there. So naturally, there are decreased productivity due to symptoms and due to side effects of medications. So ultimately, the national economy will be hampered. So naturally, it's a concern for the country itself. So today, I will only restrict myself only in a particular type of allergy from which the Indian populations are suffering much. It's a dust allergy, a fairly common problem throughout the globe, there is no doubt, including India, leading to some specific type of allergic manifestations. Say for example, allergic rhinitis, it is just sneezing and wheezing. Ultimately, urticaria, the rash, skin rash, the bronchial asthma, etc. Now, in case of allergy practice, two things are prime importance. First important is to whom you are allergic to. That means identification of offending allergy. Because as you know, the antigen-antibody reaction is very much specific. So naturally, the identification of proper allergen, identification of offending allergen is very much important. Or I'd rather to say, it's the primary function of a clinician or a medical personnel. So in case of allergy practice, two things are of prime importance. Number one is identification of offending allergen, and second important is avoidance or subsequent reduction of the offending allergens to provide best possible diagnosis and treatment. Now, just have a look. What is house dust? Because I have introduced the term house dust mite allergens. House dust is nothing but a complex mixture of substances of both plant and animal origin. And it has been recognized as a cause of sneezing. As soon as you just exposed to the dust, that the immediate action is sneezing. Isn't it? There is some sort of nasal passage is the way to enter into the body. So naturally, has been recognized as the cause of sneezing and wheezing in sensitive individuals. Association between house dust and allergy has long been suspected, till 1964. However, the exact nature of allergen inside the house dust was unknown for quite a long time. As you know, dust is a physical particle. They cannot initiate any allergic reaction because allergic reaction is an inorganic reaction. So something is there within the dust which is actually responsible for all these problems. So the exact nature of allergen within the dust was unknown for quite a long time. It was Professor Brudhorst. I'm happy to say that for a long time, quite a long time, more than 10 years I worked under Professor Brudhorst. Professor Bhuras in the year 1964 first pointed out that mites, being a student of zoology, what's my involvement in the process of allergy? Actually, the Professor Bhuras first pointed out that mites of the genus Dermatophagoides present in the house dust are the main source of allergies. So it was Professor Bhuras. Earlier idea was that something different. He first identified that there are some things, something, as you know, the insects. Insects, you know, I think. So like insects, there is another particle which is known as mites and ticks. So these mites, which is popularly known, not only that, there are 30,000 different species of mites has already been identified. Only one type of mites, that is known as genus Dermatophagoides, is present in the house dust as the main source of allergen. I'm discussing in greater detail. And this idea was supported in India by Shivpuri et al. First time in the year 1977. And during last more than 30 years, our group is also working in the same field and addressing the same agenda. That is, we have lots of publications in that field. Subsequently, allergies in this is readily available now. And bronchial provocation test clearly established that house dust mites are chiefly responsible for dust allergy. So within the dust being a physical particle cannot initiate an organic reaction, that is allergic reaction. So something is there inside within the dust. That's why dust in the outer environment does not cause any harm, because the thing that is the food is not available outside. Food is available inside the room, inside the house. That's why the house dust mite is responsible for all these complications. Now, have a look. What are mites? What are mighty mites? Mites are minute, delicate creatures, difficult to detect by the unaided eyes. It's very difficult to identify under the naked eyes. They are usually with four pairs of thoracic appendages. As you know, in animal community, there is a group in invertebrates that is known as arthropods. Arthropods means jointed appendages. It's a unique group. In evolutionary biology, they have occupied a very good position because they're the first creature to having legs, that means they can move. Say for example, and this type of leg is always bidemous. Bidemous means jointed. Say for example, if your leg is not bidemous, your movement will be like that, no? You can't speed, it's not possible. Whenever it is possible, only if you can move, just if it is, if there is a joint. Jointed leg is very much important. So this is the evolutionary biology, this is the landmark. Say for example, you know the earthworm? Earthworm, you know? Earthworm.
Yes.
And there is a cockroach. The food is here. Who will reach the food first? Cockroach. Not only cockroach. It will take less and less time than the earthworm can perform. So why? Evolutionary biology, only the legs is the marker of progressive evolution. So they are having these legs. So these insects, this type of arthropods, they can just fold their legs. So naturally, number of legs is important. In insects, it is usually three pairs. In case of mites, it is usually four pairs. You know the spiders? Spider is an arachnid. So it looks like a spider, small creature, that is actually inside the dust, which is actually problem. Mouthwash with pedipalpi and chelicery. Throughout the globe, 30,000 species of mites have already been described. Usually fungivorous, algivorous, saprovorous, occurs in all ecological niches and ubiquitous in nature. This is in a nutshell an idea about the mites, what those who are new to the topics, only for them actually. So mites are something, unique specimens belonging to the group Arthropoda, which can fold their legs and having four pairs of thoracic appendages. So this is a nice impression about the mites. Thanks God, 30,000 mites have already been identified throughout the globe. Among them, only these 11 species are allergic mites throughout the globe. And among them,
these four, the last four, 8, 9, 10, and 11, are really doing havoc in Indian context. So these are the actually our concern, these four species of mites. Among them, these two is very much important. Why? The group is belonging to the genus Dermatophagoidae. Actually, just a minute. These are some of the mice. You see four pairs of legs. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. These are all mites. Among them, there is a group known as Dermatophagoidae. Why Dermatophagoidae? Derm means human skin cells. They feed on, phagoidae means they feed on. So they feed only on human skin cells. That's why it's known as Dermatophagoidae. So this group is actually important from the allergy point of view. So the genus Dermatophagoidae was the most prevalent one in house dust. There is no doubt. Why? They are free living, concentrated mainly on beds. Why in beds? Because food is ensured. We have periodic shedding, no? Skin, human skin cells, which is known as human dander, that is being deposited in the beds. So ultimately, this is actually the site of their occurrence. So, this genus, that means Dermatophagoidae genus, was most prevalent one in the house dust. They occupy mainly the beds because of the reasons two. One is the bed provides the ideal microclimate for their survival. What happens? Usually, an allergic patient or asthma patient lying on the bed, no? Between the bed and his body, there is a gap, which ultimately accumulates maximum amount of moisture. Is it true?
Yeah.
Whenever you are lying on the bed, mm-hmm. just at the juncture of your back and the bed, the region is mostly with high humidity. And this mites is very much important in terms of humidity. If there is any less humidity, they won't survive. So this is the region, this is the actually niche, you know the niche, N-I-C-H-E, niche concept? That means the preferred most, the area which preferred most by this thing is actually this interface between your body and the bed. And maximum time, maximum shedding of your body will be deposited over there. That ensures the food source. So naturally, beds are the ideal site for their survival. So they feed mainly on human skin scales or shedding. Interestingly, very recently, Professor Tovey, 2008, pointed out that 95% of the allergens origin are in the fecal matters. Why? It has opened a new vista in this science. Earlier idea was like that you just can kill mites, ultimately you can remove it, the problem from your surroundings. But now it is proved that both dead and live mites are equally important. Because the allergenic origin is from their fecal particles. So whether they are live mites or dead mites, that does not matter. So this is actually opposite. This is actually there are some mites, in house dust mites actually. They are roaming on the quilt. Now the house dust mites. Genus Dermatophagoidae. That means they feed on human skin cells. Only two important mites have been identified throughout the globe. One is Dermatophagoidae terunicinas, usually known as European house dust mites. That means they are confined in the European regions only. And second one is Diferini, it's popularly known as American house dust mites. They were confined in the American region. Unfortunately, in Calcutta population, what you get, both the mice coexist in the same habitat.
India?
In India, in Calcutta, where I am working actually,
both
are present. Why? Due to its high humidity throughout the year. And it actually creates a lot of problems in our research. This is our main target. Why? The identification of DP and DA, pure culture, is very much difficult. Say, to prepare the allergenic extracts, you need 5 to 3 crores of mites. you are doing these things in your laboratory, suddenly there is a there is a contamination. It's really a problem. It's very easy to sound, but it's only the difficulties which I am facing last 30 years. Actually, it's very difficult to maintain the pure culture. Anything, say, just fan on, ultimately, everything will be contaminated. This is really a problem for Calcutta people. But for them, only deuterium is available. So pure culture is readily available, isn't it? So this is one of the problems which I am facing last during my work. This is deuterium. This is deferrine. Now, I am just giving you a short glimpses of my work, which we are performing in our laboratory during last more than 28 years. Data is here. In view of the remarkable increase in the incidence of allergic disease in Kolkata metropolis in the recent past, a comprehensive study has been undertaken involving the STM, the great institute, Calcutta School of Tropical Medicine, our Calcutta University support. There is an organization, AARC, Allergy and Asthma Research Center. These three groups are involved. Being a team leader, I am working in this field. We have prepared an inventory of the houseless mite fauna of India. Total India, I am representing here only the Calcutta populations. A total of 53 species we have identified, belonging to 34 genera, 12 families and 3 orders already been identified. 18 species recorded for the first time from Indian subcontinent. 7 species have been identified as new to science. That means the new species we have described is already 7. It's a remarkable, it's a matter to mention definitely. Dermatopheres alone constitute 60% of the total occurring fauna, predominated by TP. TP stands for D. teronicinas, Dermatopheres teronicinas. Followed by BT. BT means Bromia tropicalis. And we are the first group throughout the globe identified BT mites as the main cause of allergy in India subcontinent. DL is there, Dermatopheres felini, Astroglycifigus geniculatus. So these four is actually problem in Calcutta populations. First position being DP, followed by BT, DL and HE. Both DP and DL coexisted in the same habitats. Maximum number of mites isolated, around 14,000 per gram of dust, mined it. Only 4 or 5 or 6 mites is sufficient to initiate the program. And we have identified the species whose base contains more around 14,000 mites per gram of dust. Just 1 gram of dust contains 14,000 pieces of mites. Patient's bay contains significantly higher mite population than the healthy control beds. Why? Usually we neglect the general health and hygiene in bed. Usually what happens? He's lying on the bed, it's not frequently dusted or otherwise it's maintained. But in case of controls, we used to clean our beds in that cases. So present patient's bed contains significantly higher mite population than the healthy control bed does. Bed does contains significantly higher concentration of mites than the corresponding bedroom floor does. Why? Bed is the main niche for their survival. At the same time, it ensures the food source for the from the human denders. Foam mattresses contain significantly higher mite density than the cotton mattress. In Indian context, we are very much orthodox usually, earlier at least. We use the traditional cotton mattresses. And it is largely being replaced by the foam mattresses. And this is a dangerous one for the survival of these mites. It's a bait for mites multiplications. So naturally, this is we have identified the foam mattress contains significantly higher mite density than the cotton mattress. And very recently, we used to, with the quilt, isn't it? Usually the traditional quilt in Indian context. But very recently, we have introduced the blankets without any cover. It looks good. It can be.